guys before the fights tonight?
I know both guys. We're grizzled veteran is a good phrase. We're grizzled veterans. Mr. Chavez has a terrible record, but he's one of these guys that used to exist in boxing 20 to 30 years ago, what we call a road warrior, a journeyman. He's got 18 losses, but he's only been stopped in three of them, and he fights very good guys normally. You know, he's fighting an undefeated guy tonight. Quite frankly, you know, Martez Potter is not the best guy that Chavez is fighting. So this is not a mismatch, even though on paper it's a mismatch. Martez is 5-0. He has one knockout. He's not a big puncher. Martez had about 60 to 65 amateur fights, but he's still, when you watch him as a pro, he's still learning. He's still a semi-novice fighter as a professional, and Chavez Fernandez is definitely not a novice fighter. So competitively, this should be a good fight. I can guarantee you almost that there will not be a knockout because neither guy is a puncher, and Chavez is very experienced at going the rounds, and that's his plan in every fight. Win or lose, he's going to go the rounds.
Well, we're going to go up to our ring announcer right now for the official introductions, Mike Otis.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're ready to continue with boxing action here at the Holiday Inn in Liverpool, New York. This will be six rounds in the middleweight division and our co-main event of the evening. Let's introduce our two fighters. We'll start in the blue corner. He weighs in at 155 pounds, wearing the orange trunk with black trim. He fights out of Brockton, Massachusetts, and enters the ring with a record of 4 wins, 18 losses, and 2 draws. Ladies and gentlemen, make some noise for Antonio Chavez Fernandez. And his opponent fighting out of the red corner. He weighs in at 155 pounds, wearing the blue trunks with gold trim. He hails from Syracuse, New York, and enters the ring with a record of 5 wins, no losses, and no draws, and 1 win, coming by the way of knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, make some noise for Martez, the Punisher Potter.
You know, Eric, you make a point about a fighter like Antonio Fernandez, who's got an upside-down record. It is still popular overseas in England. You see it a lot, you know, and it is something. I think here in the States, we look at a record like that, we immediately, you know, dismiss him as being not a quality fighter, but these guys have experience. And the one other thing I want to make a point of Martez Potter as the two guys start this fight. Potter is in the blue trunks with the gold trim, and Antonio Fernandez is in the orange trunks with the black trim. He's moved down in weight. He fought at super middleweight, and he's barely making the middleweight division now. He weighed 155.8 pounds. Rumor has it that he wants to go down to junior middleweight. Maybe the knockouts will come as he starts facing smaller guys.
That's true. I don't think he's going to get the knockout tonight because, like I said, Fernandez has fought much harder punchers, much more experienced fighters. But you're right, moving down 10 pounds in weight, you know, obviously that extra weight that he was carrying wasn't muscle, you know, because he wasn't going to lose it if it was.
Right.
So he'll be a little lighter, a little quicker, and when you have more speed, you have more power.
Yeah, and generally as people age, as I can vouch for, you gain weight. So I think you're right. I think that this is a Martez Potter is an indication that maybe boxing has helped get him in better physical shape, and he's fighting more where he should, you know, middleweight, junior middleweight, that kind of weight division.
Yeah, and you'll see Potter in the beginning here. He's not throwing educated punches. He's throwing wide punches when he was inside rather than you know, dip and throw power punches to the body. He shoe shine, so he's still learning. He's still an amateur turning pro almost, even though he's had 5 professional fights. And this is going to be a very good learning experience for him because he's going to see things that he's never seen before from Fernandez.
That's why I was saying earlier that sometimes, you know, when you have these elite fighters like Floyd Mayweather, who's fighting this weekend against Marcos Maidana, you know, it's almost like you know, I get into this argument, and people get, you know, all, I ruffle their tail feathers when I say a guy like Mayweather could actually be bad for boxing for several reasons, but one of them is that kids will try to emulate him, and, you know, you can't, you know, and it's hard to copy, and like you were saying before, you know, if a fighter picks up a bad habit from watching somebody, it could make their own career not go where it should, you know?
Correct.
Like you mentioned with Potter, you know, doing that shoe shine.
I don't know who he's emulating, you know, because he's, you know, he's not a smooth fighter. You know, his punches don't flow. He's kind of herky-jerky. He doesn't throw them correctly. He throws the right hand like he's swinging a hammer. You know, but like I said, this is, you know, you get experience and you learn. He's going to watch a tape after this fight. His coaches at the Syracuse Boxing Club are going to point out what he does wrong. And, you know, he'll improve. You know, I don't know how much he can improve, but he's going to improve, and he's going to improve a lot from this fight.
You know, it seems like he's got the body and the natural ability to do a little better. He's almost fighting like he's got pop behind his punches. You know, like he's fighting like he's a power puncher. But he's not. I think he should settle down and try to be more refined.
Correct. Yeah, I mean, he'll learn to relax as he goes along, and he'll learn to settle in, as you said. You made a great point about Travis Fernandez, and it's good that the New York Commission lets a guy like this fight in a fight like this, because it is a competitive fight. There's guys in England, as you pointed out, there's active fighters in England that have more than 100 losses.
Oh, I know. There's a guy that just fought a couple of weekends ago. His record was something like 8-96 or something like that, you know, but those are the kinds of guys that help young fighters, and I agree with you. You got to give the New York State Athletic Commission some credit, because, you know, when I was promoting fights, they had a rule, a ridiculous rule, that they wouldn't let a fighter who lost 3 fights in a row, not knockouts, 3 fights in a row, fight. And when you look at this, you got a fighter with 5 pro fights against, you know, a guy that's got, you know, 22 professional fights, 24 professional fights. It's not a mismatch, you know, because of the experience level. And you're right, you know, Fernandez, you know, he's got a solid chin, and you know, he's fighting a guy that doesn't have a lot of knockouts. He's only got one. But this is a fight that Martez Potter should be learning from. He should be, like you said, he should be, you know, seeing things that he's never seen before, and this should help him immensely throughout his career.
Correct. And like I said, it's not going to end early. It's going to go the distance. So he's got 18 minutes to learn. It's a very good sparring session. And also, he's got to be careful in there. He can't just do exactly what he wants, because Chavez Fernandez, even though he's limited in his skills, he's trying to win the fight. You know, he's not in there to go the distance, and he's not in there just to survive. He knows that Martez Potter is probably not going to be able to hurt him. And, you know, even looking at his record now, being into the ring with him. So he's in with the guy, Potter, meaning right now, who's trying to win the fight, even though the guy is very limited himself skill-wise. So that's a very good experience for Potter. He's just not hitting the heavy bag.
Right, right. Well, you know, I think that if you look at it realistically, and if you're part of Martez Potter's team, you know, you want to get a hold of the tape of this fight and show him, you know, this is what you could have done, this is what you shouldn't have done, and stuff like that. I mean, it seems like Martez Potter has a lot of confidence in himself, but sometimes you have to watch the tape and see what, you know, the mistakes that you're making, because, like you said, when you're punching a heavy bag, everybody looks good.
Correct.
Glad you could join us. We're coming at you live from the Holiday Inn in Liverpool, New York. We're in the sixth fight of a 7-fight card being put on by JKJ Championship Promotions, and we've been treated to a fantastic night of boxing, very competitive, entertaining fights. Glad you could join us. And speaking of joining me, I'm Billy C, and I'm joined with Eric Botcher. And Eric, I'm glad you made the trip up north. And, you know, rumor had it you were thinking of bringing a pair of shorts, but you didn't need it up here, huh?
No, it's nice weather. Look, if I could have a summer home, it would be in upstate New York. I love it up here. It's beautiful weather. It's beautiful country. But I'm in Florida, so when it gets cold up here, not so anxious to come up to watch the fights.
Well, I'll make you a deal. Next summer, you come and stay with me. We'll go out on a boat, and during the winter, I'll come down and stay with you. How about
that's
that?
That's a deal.
We'll have some fun for sure. Listen, we're going to be taking a commercial break at the end of this round, but don't go anywhere. We're taking a commercial break, but don't you go anywhere, because we're going to see you at the beginning of round number three.
Ralph's Collision, located in Oneida, New York, has been serving the central New York community for over 48 years. A family-owned business, Ralph's Collision uses only the highest quality, factory-authorized parts and paint products for all your automobile repairs. From small dings to major collision repairs, Ralph does it all. We accept assignment from all the major insurance carriers and handle all the paperwork to make your claim experience the best. And we take the time to do the job right. Ralph's Collision is located at 1673 Genesee Street at Five Corners in Oneida, across the street from Walmart. Look for the signature bright orange trucks out front, and we're open Monday through Saturday for your convenience. For a free estimate, call us anytime at 315-363-6860. When you want the job done right, think of Ralph's Collision for all your automotive collision repair needs.
And we're back, round number three of a scheduled six-round fight in the middleweight division. Martez Potter in the blue trunks with the gold trim is taking on experienced grizzled veteran Antonio Fernandez, who's in the orange trunks with the black trim. And so far, it looks like exactly what we thought.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty pedestrian action, and Chamez Fernandez does just enough to stay behind, like one step behind. Potter just clipped him with a nice right hand there, and Chamez Fernandez did a little dip.
He just got nailed again with a good shot, but like you said before the action started tonight, that Fernandez has a solid chin, and he's displaying it right now. But, you know, Fernandez looks, you know, like exactly what he is, an experienced fighter, because he just seems, you know, like this is business as usual, and Potter acts like the young fighter who's hasn't learned to do the right thing sometimes.
Right.
You know?
Well, you can see when Chavez Fernandez punches, he punches correctly, but he punches out of range. He's not landing these jabs. He's hitting the gloves. He's hitting the elbows. He's hitting the forearms. He follows up with the right, which is even shorter than the left. So he looks the part. Physically, he looks fine. His stamina is good. But as far as a threat to him winning the fight, he's just always a step behind this guy. He's always a step behind. And then when he gets clipped, he'll come right back. But he's behind because he's been clipped.
You know, you're right. And, you know, being as experienced as you are, you see that a lot of this problem is Fernandez and not Potter. That's making him do those things. You know, it's Fernandez that's doing it to himself, basically.
Correct.
You know? And my question to you is, when you're dealing with, if you're a trainer and you're dealing with a young fighter like Martez Potter, and you see that his opponent is actually making the mistakes himself, how do you get your fighter on track? Because he's going back to the corner thinking he's doing everything right.
What you have to point out to him is, look, he's, you know, Martez is doing some things right. You know, there's an axiom in boxing, you know, be first. You want to be first. You want to be first. And for the most part, he's first, because he doesn't have a lot coming back at him. The only time Chavez Fernandez gets animated, so to speak, is when he gets hit. So, you know, Potter should catch up on that, and when he's able to reach Fernandez with a clean punch, rather than get wild, calmly step over, set him up for another punch, go to the body. Not going to miss the body, because he's, you know, he's winging those punches to the head and he's missing a lot of them. You know, there's a lot of different things you can do with an opponent like this, because you know what Chavez Fernandez is going to do every time. He's very predictable.
You know, Potter is fighting in spurts, and I don't see a jab from this kid.
Yeah, like I said, he's very herky-jerky. He's very unorthodox. He's not smooth. He doesn't have a classic style, and he doesn't throw classic punches.
I think if he learned how to throw a jab, other things would come into, you know, I mean,
it would help, right?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think that it would be, you know, advantageous for him, because I haven't seen him throw one jab.
It's advantageous for any fighter to know how to throw a jab. Not saying he doesn't know how to throw it, but like you said, he's not using it at all.
Right. When I was boxing as a kid, I'll never forget my trainer. That's what he said. He said the most important thing is a jab. And he said good fighters have a natural jab. He said it's hard to teach one, you know. And when I see fighters that don't even try and throw a jab, you know, you say to yourself, what's going on? And here's a kid who's undefeated. You know, he's fighting, you know, the right fights. He's obviously into what he's doing. He's animated, like you said, but he doesn't throw a jab.
Tell you what, when I was boxing as a kid, my trainer always said, why don't you duck once in a while?
Yeah. Stop eating all those punches. You know, why don't you move your head a little?
Why don't you move your head before his fist hits your head?
Yeah. Or, you know, it's like, did you ever see a punch you didn't like, you know, to take in the face? But anyway, round number four of a scheduled six-round fight. We got the same thing going on, round after round. It's like Groundhog Day. But, you know, it's like, you know, I don't mean to be so critical of Martez Potter, but he seems to be doing the same thing, and he fights like he thinks he's got this knockout punch. I don't know, man. I think if the kid just stuck a jab out and, you know, he would be able to set up other punches. He's actually smothering his own punches.
You know, he's in good shape. He's not tired because, look, he's fighting with a lot of energy. And you can tell he's very tense in there. He's not a relaxed fighter.
Yep.
So he's in fantastic physical condition. He's very well trained. But if he would calm down a little bit, smooth out a lot of rough edges, and use the jab, as you said, he'd have a lot more success. He wouldn't get Fernandez out of there, but he would not get hit as much because he is getting hit once in a while, and he'd land a lot more.
Yeah, I'm surprised that his team isn't working on a jab with him.
Like, I'm sure they are. I see some of these guys, especially with these weird, unorthodox styles that you know is not being taught to him. It's just him.
Yeah, but what happens usually is if a fighter is being, if a trainer's working on something physically, like let's say a jab, normally a fighter will come out and try to work it, what they've been working on, and then abandon it, like if he gets in trouble or something like that, he goes back to his comfort zone. I haven't seen him try to throw it. I haven't seen one jab from him, not one. And like we said, he's not a knockout puncher. So, I mean, it's not, you know, sometimes you'll see a knockout puncher just go for the kill because they're used to watching their opponents fall, and you can't say that with him. The mind of a fighter, Eric.
It's a very scary place. Sometimes it's a very vacant place, too.
The mind. It's a terrible thing to waste. It looks like Fernandez is taking a breather here as we get ready to end the fourth round of a scheduled six-round fight. Now, this is how you get disqualified.
Well, this is just unnecessary.
See, now, I think that Paul Brown is doing the right thing. But these two fighters should get warned right here.
Right. Well, I mean, exactly. I mean, like I said, Potter. He's obviously not a relaxed fighter, and that's a case where you need to be relaxed and keep your head. You know, that's being a professional.
Yeah.
And Chavez saw that, and he tried to get into his head a little more. He was actually being smart because he saw how hyper that he got. He knew that he could maybe go this guy into a point deduction or even a disqualification.
Well, as soon as he came back out, I think you're right. And I think that Paul Brown, who's the referee here, I think he took control of the situation, and I think that he just went over to each corner and obviously gave them a stern warning, and I think he did a good job with that. And as a result, you see them touch gloves, so obviously Paul did a great job in that, and that was kind of strange. Stupid rookie mistakes, right? Young fighter mistakes doing that, right?
Yeah, you always have to keep your head. You always have to control your own emotions.
We're in round number five of a scheduled six rounder in the middleweight division. Martez Potter in the blue trunks with the gold trim and the sequins sticking all over Fernandez, who's in the orange trunks with the black trim. And, you know, for a fighter that, you know, is not known for his power punches, he is landing some solid shots on Fernandez. But as you indicated in the very beginning, he's got a solid chin.
Yeah, Fernandez is very solid. And when Potter lands these punches, they're not sneak punches. They do come at from odd angles, but he's winging them from so far away, and he's winding up for them from all these different angles, where Fernandez can always, even though they're coming from different angles, he can see them coming. He's not surprised by any of them.
No, and all he's got to do is move slightly, and then everything is off the punch. But like we've said, you know, punches are set up with a jab. And if you're not going to throw a jab, you're not setting up any punches. Is that his version of the show? See what I mean? You know, and, you know, got to know how to do it if you're going to do it, you know. You know, it's interesting. You know, we've seen a slew of four-round fights tonight, and a lot of them seemed like the fighters were more refined than what we're watching right now, even though these guys have more experience.
Potter's never going to be a refined fighter. I mean, he's always going to have this strange style. He can smooth it out a bit. I mean, some guys are just, you know, just the way he's going to fight.
But they need a fighter like that needs something else, either power or something that's going to help him get by.
Well, he needs to learn because, you know, he's never going to have power. So he needs to learn. Like you said, he needs to learn how to use a jab. He needs to learn to calm down, and he can have a different variety of punches like he has now, but if he refines his punches, he'll have a lot more success because, you know, the way he throws his punches now, he's not surprising his opponent at all.
And like I said earlier, and, you know, it's evident now, is he fights in spurts. And what I mean by that isn't like he's saving his energy because, like you said, he's in great shape. But when he lunges forward and lets his hands go, if he throws four, five, six punches, then he does this. And he doesn't throw any punches. And then he comes back four, five, six punches. You know, and that's, you know, what I think is hurting him. You know? It's the end of the fifth round. We got one more round to go here in the middleweight division. And, you know, just like you said, Fernandez is in there doing his part. I don't think this is a close fight on the scorecards. But honestly, it's not even that interesting, you know, because, you know, well, only because it's the same thing over and
correct.
Over. I don't mean it in a, I know it's hard for me to well, say. I don't mean this in
no,
a
you're
negative
right. No, they're both doing the same thing. And look, we know what Fernandez does every round. And, you know, Potter should take advantage of that. I mean, he really should because he is the guy with better ability. I mean, he doesn't have a lot more ability than Fernandez, but he can see that Fernandez is doing the same thing over and over. He's throwing the same punches. He throws them the same way in the same sequence. And he also knows that the only time Fernandez opens up is when Potter himself lands.
Well, I think it shows you that, you know, you got a guy like Fernandez who's into this sport, obviously, and he just is a guy that doesn't have a lot of skill, but he's got a lot of heart, you know.
He's got a lot of know-how. He knows how not to get hurt, which is, a journeyman opponent, that's the number one objective, is they don't want to get hurt. They want to live to fight another day. A fighter like Chavez Fernandez fights every month. He fights good fighters. He gets paid well. He doesn't get stopped. He doesn't want to get cut. And he wants to keep going.
Yeah,
whereas Potter, his goal should be completely different,
right,
to where he wants to learn, number one, but he wants to improve. He should be working on different things. He should be working on different varieties of attacks. And he knows he's got a guy in there that doesn't do that. So he should be the one doing that.
Right, and he's not. And that's what I'm saying. Like, you know, that's why I would have liked to have seen him at least start the first round trying to use a jab. And then, you know, then you could say, well, he just doesn't have the experience. He reverts back to what he knows. But, you know, let me ask you a question from a matchmaker's perspective. Fernandez sitting on a 4-18 record with a couple of draws. How long does a fighter have a career like that? I mean, at some point in time, you know, he's gonna the opportunity is not gonna be there, you know, because he loses so many fights in a row, forgetting, you know, the fact that he goes the distance, he doesn't get hurt. I mean, when's the cutoff?
The cutoff is when he, look, for someone of his weight class, his condition, his style, he can be around as long as he wants. He's going to have to win a fight every once in a while.
Right.
Look, he can fight in Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Virginia, there's
Arkansas,
a few, you know, Carolinas. He can fight in certain states to where they don't mind if he loses 9 or 10 in a row. But when you get up there and you've lost 13, 14, 15 in a row, every state's going to say, hey, buddy, you know, it's time for you to go out and get another occupation.
Or so he's limited to 4-round fights where he's not making the money.
Yeah, so he's got to win, you know, he's got to have wins sprinkled into these types of fights for him to keep going, keep his career going, and, you know, keep making money.
And that's how you make a living, finding the right guy to match him up with. So
well,
that he
see,
looks
that's,
like
that's the thing. It's whoever handles him, that's their job. You know, it's easy to throw him in whenever you get a phone call and say, hey, look, you know, we're going to pay you X amount. Just show up and fight. We know what's going to happen. You know, you're going to give a good account of yourself. My guy needs experience. Whoever handles him, if he handles himself or if it's a trainer, if he actually has a manager, they've got to put him in a position every once in a while where he's the favorite.
Right. Well, that's going to be far and few in between. That's the final bell. 6-round fight. We're going to look at a quick replay of the last portion of this fight, which was one of the more action-packed parts of this fight. As you see, Potter here with his hands down, and Fernandez is doing what he does, just playing his role. You know? No knockout, no danger.
Yeah, see, you know, Fernandez threw two jabs that were short, followed up with the right hand that was shorter, grabbed, and Potter really doesn't do anything.
No, he's clearly not an experienced fighter, and they need to work on a jab with him or something. And I think you said it best with Fernandez. I mean, this is a guy that just is struggling with distance. I think you said it right from the get-go. It's a problem with distance. It was evident on that replay.
Well, I think he knows the distance. The distance for him is safe.
Yeah.
Safety.
Right.
You know,
right.
It's
right.
Like, you know what, if I'm just short with my jab, he can't hit me with his jab. If I'm just short with my right hand, he can't hit me.
And here's an illustration, like you were talking about with Potter. You know, he's just throwing wild punches.
Yeah.
You know, he did happen to land one there, but he wasn't in position to throw another punch.
Yep.
You know, but anyway, we're getting the official scores here, and we're going to go up to our ring announcer, Mike Otis, when he reads the give us the official scores here in 1 second right now.
All right, ladies and gentlemen.
To be honest with you, where did that 58-56 score come from? I mean, do you, I mean, listen, we were sitting here watching the whole fight. You know.